And welcome. Reinventing a career is tough, but particularly if you're a woman, it can be tougher, and more so maybe if you're in the engineering or the computing world. Well, I'm going to talk to someone who can tell us and take us through her own journey of how she's done it and the challenges that she's faced. I'm joined by Maitreyi Ganapathy, Principal Group Manager at Microsoft. Put it in English, she leads one of the main engineers on the Bing search program.
Yes.
Maitreyi, thank you very much for speaking with us.
Thank you.
You'd love to re-engineer and reinvent, re-engineer Bing. Every few years. So what makes you do that, and what are the challenges that you faced in trying to do that?
Well, I think I get bored very quickly, and I also like to do a lot of the front end part of building something. In my career, it's about building products. And so the strategizing and defining what would the consumer actually see in his or her hands when they start working on it, either software or any other product or program. And that really excites me and gets me going. And the last part, which is executing and getting it into the hands of people, to me seems a lot more tactical. And while it's important to do, and if you don't do it, then as a leader, you've not succeeded, it's not as exciting to me.
Spoken like a true engineer, by the way. Yeah.
And so I think, and then of course you want to build yourself, right? Yeah. Like every time you grow because you're going outside your comfort zone and doing something completely different. And I love to do that. I don't know why. I don't feel that it's a risk. Mm. I feel that if I fail, maybe I fail a few years of my career early as opposed to later. And I think the risk of failing earlier is much more than if I fail later. Mm-hmm. And so I want to take those risks now, and I feel like I have the appetite for it, so I do it.
So what did you work on before Bing?
Before Bing, I worked on the ads program that Bing now supports, the way we generate money, I guess, off of search. So I worked on that for 2 years. I worked on a lot of key things, one of which was actually enabling the Yahoo migration onto the Bing platform.
Right. So each time you've tried to reinvent, and
yes,
you're also, on the personal side, you've also had kids and you've moved places or relocated,
yes,
from the US back to India and so,
yeah,
on. So how have you managed both these environments?
I don't know. I don't know if I managed it well. Sometimes you do things because you have to. And over time, you kind of come up with the rhythm. Mm. And I kind of feel like that's what happened because, you're a new parent. I had my first child, a girl, 8 years ago, and then I had my younger one 3 years back, and just barely when you're done with settling into the first one, suddenly the second one comes and the rhythm doesn't work anymore. So I don't know that I've figured it out. I'm doing the best that I can, and right now no one's like screaming from the rooftops within my family. So I feel like you figure it out just like you figure it out at work, right?
Mm.
And the best analogy I can think of is, I am reinventing myself with great vigor, energy, and excitement at work. Well, then maybe I should figure out a way to reinvent myself in my family side as well.
Mm.
So I look at it that way, and then my children bring me great joy. So it balances out.
Right. So what are the physical challenges of trying to reinvent oneself? I know it sounds good,
yeah,
but you're also trying to go to your organization and tell them that you want to do something.
Yes.
Maybe it has a family impact as well, because,
yeah,
it maybe mean new location, new timings, more intensity and so on.
Yeah. One thing that helped me is that I'm very clear on my priorities. And even though I love my career, I am very clear that my family is my priority. So if I find myself in a job where, and I have done this, if I find myself in a job where I feel that the parameters of the job, which actually includes a lot of things, like you said, it could be the location, it could be the timing, it could also be other leaders that I'm working with. And if they don't quite respect the parameters that I am setting with, in which I want to do the job, I leave.
Mm.
And I'm very clear that it's okay to do that, because ultimately, and I think a lot of women don't get this right, we're working because we want to create a better life for those around us.
Mm-hmm.
That includes obviously our peer group, the customers you want to influence, but also your family, right? And if you don't have that clarity, that it's okay sometimes not to be so good in your work, because you ultimately want to be the best for your family, it should be fine. There's no need to feel guilty. There's no need to blame anybody. Just cut and move on.
Mm-hmm.
And I've never had that confusion.
But you feel others do?
Yes, I feel a lot of women do, actually. And they feel guilty about work, and they feel guilty about home. And I don't feel that.
Mm-hmm.
And so the one thing I tell a lot of, you know, other women who are growing in their career themselves and trying to balance things is I say, make the choice. In some cases, and maybe it's day to day, maybe it's from job to job, maybe you have to say no. Sometimes you're saying no to your family, but make that decision way more carefully than how you say no to your job. Mm-hmm. It's way more easy for me to say no to my job than to my family.
Right. So what are the, I mean, in a more structural sense, how do these issues get addressed or resolved in an organization or across organizations for so many women who want to perhaps come back to the workforce or stick to the workforce or become better at the workforce?
It doesn't get addressed very well. So, you know, a lot of companies, especially the larger ones where diversity is important, I'm sure you've heard this before many times, right? That if you're building a consumer-facing product, you want to have representation of the users.
Right.
And if women are 51% of the world's population, then you better have some representation in what you're trying to build. And so for that reason, a lot of...
I was told an iPhone would be quite different if there were women in the design team.
Yeah,
or more
true.
Women in the design
team. Actually, kitchens would be built very different if women built kitchens and not men. But anyway, it's a separate pet peeve of mine. But the point I'm trying to make is there's a lot of organizational direction to say, okay, how do you bring more women in? But I don't know that we have figured out, and we're all experimenting, right? There aren't many companies who have it nailed and say, this is exactly how I'm going to make sure that I see less attrition in women in general. I see less attrition of women at inflection points, which is when they either get married or have kids or, you know, something big in their life. I think we're all figuring it out. We haven't quite nailed it. But at least I think if you're talking about it, you're in the stage where you will figure out, okay, what should be the next step.
Right. So how do you place all of this in the context of India?
Well, you know, one of the questions, I should give you this example, I get asked most often when I do some of these talks is, how do you deal with your mother-in-law?
Yeah, I was coming to that.
I don't get this question when I used to give talks in the US. And so, see, this is what is unique to India, right? Where you are, whether you like it or not, you are growing up with a family, an extended family. And that family nowadays is not living with you, but they're still very much an extended family.
Yeah, and they're governing your existence.
They're governing your existence. My mother still calls me every day and tells me what a bad mother I am compared to what she was when she was bringing me up. Mm. She's not meaning it negatively, but she's just commenting on how little time I spend with my children comparatively. Mm. So it's there every day, right? I don't know that an American mother would tell the same thing to her grown daughter now. So there's social and cultural pressure, perceived behavior that women have to exhibit. When it's a festival, I feel pressured, whether I like it or not, to be at home with my mother-in-law and help her, you know, be part of that. Yeah, exactly. And, you know, some days, some festival years, I'm happy doing it because I have the freedom. And some festival years, I don't, because there'll be a VP that I have to plan for a visit for the next day. So, you know, it's a how do you balance and how do you deal with it? And like I said, it's about making the choice, right? Some years I have said no. And
to whom?
To my mother-in-law.
Okay.
And she's been graceful about it because she understands the dynamics now. And we've grown together through that dynamic. But yeah, it's you know, I think it's an explanation and it's a give and take. And you figure it out, just like you figure it out at work.
Right. So what would you tell, I mean, last question really, I mean, sure. You know, a young person who's now entering the world of engineering or computing, as the case may be, you know, maybe asking some questions about what are the choices do I make? Because the world is also changing. Maybe the world, when you entered the workforce, was a little different from what it is today.
Sure.
And India itself is seeing a lot of economic progress, higher women participation in employment, education before that, and so on.
Yeah. Well, I would say be more participative in all aspects of life. I think there's a lot of women who are still actually kind of stuck in one generation before me, where, you know, it was good to be a good Indian wife and be a good daughter-in-law and maintain family values. There's a whole lot of other women who think, I just want to have a career, I want to travel, I want to make money, I want to buy luxury items. And all of which are fine. I think it's perfectly fine for the same person to do both. And that's what I mean by being participative, right? I would ask young women, for that matter, young males entering the workforce to say, explore. I think in India what we lack is ability to just go out and try new things. Like the Peace Corps in the US, I wish I had that program. I would have learned so much in doing that as opposed to entering the workforce right away. We don't have that, but what I mean is make mistakes, you know, do things you wouldn't want to do. So what if you're an engineer, you know, go do photography for a year. I think they have the ability and the freedom to take those risks, this generation, but I don't see them taking as much of it as they could. Mm-hmm. So I would still say they should up the risk quotient.
Okay, and that's a very warm and encouraging note to end. Thank you so much for speaking to us.
Yes, thank you.